the centerboard, there's a lot of different ways you could look at the centerboard. Okay, you could look at it how it comes up out of the boat and what it's doing underneath the boat. I know of a sailor now.
Oh, I capsized him. Kind
of. You capsized him? So you didn't have a tight enough shock cord on it. So you could. Yeah, so having the shock cord on properly is important. Like, you can have all the different pieces, Chris, but you have to make sure that you have to put the pieces together properly. So if we're trying to win a sailboat race, like you can have the sail ties, beautiful, mommy and daddy, you've got your sail ties, you're out sailing, but if they're not tied properly, they blow off.
And then you're in the middle of a race and then you're passing.
And so with the centerboard, if you're upside down, it's going to take you a lot more time to get the boat upright.
Well, if
the centerboard's, if you can't get to it.
Yeah.
I'm just saying how, if he knows he's going down, he'll try to throw the board down so he'll have something to help him. And I know that laser sailors, who I've known, when they're sailing, sometimes the boat oscillates. Now that's a rounded hull.
Yeah.
This is unique. Yeah. Is this boat round?
No.
Square. Square. So does this boat go blunk blunk?
No.
Or does it go whoosh,
whoosh?
It goes blunk blunk. So in the laser, it goes.
You kind of actually like stay in the middle.
You stay in the middle, okay? You want to balance the boat with your body.
Going down when like. And you do not want to go down when your body weight on one side of the wheel capsizes a big gust.
So O'Connor's saying you do want to get your boat to the windward side so you can kite the boat, and that brings the sail up, and it reduces your wetted surface area. All this is wet. Now, very few boats in will have corners, right? How many corners does this have?
Four
corners. I don't know, like, the laser has
one.
Does it have a corner at all?
It has three.
I guess you can kind of count the bow.
You can kind of count the bow as a corner, and
it's
in the back,
three.
Maybe it has 2.5 corners, or maybe it has 1.5 corners. So in this case, do you think the corners are going to affect you?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, what do you think we should do with those corners when we're sailing?
Out of the water.
Get them out of the water. How do you get the corners out of the water?
Tip the boat a little bit.
By using your weight around the boat to kind of shift you around.
So kind of like a gyroscope.
Yeah.
Oh, a gyroscope.
And that's how you're going upwind and light winds, you want to get inside the boat. And
when I'm on the front end and just have fun, I just sit always back corner to all my sides are out.
So you just go and lounge.
I just
sit all the way
in the back.
Like
the back
not sailing. Okay, so that's one thing now.
But not when I'm racing.
Now, when you go and when you capsized, your board fell out of the boat, right? That was bad.
And like that.
But I know of a guy who is he's a coach at the United States Merchant Marine Academy, and when he was a boy, he fell in love with this stuff. You guys have seen this?
Oh, yeah.
I've heard of it.
Yeah, it's a dry lubricant. So, water's a lubricant, but this is dry. But isn't it nice if you could have things slide easy?
Yeah.
Wow. So, Michael and I were talking. This is good on blocks, like pulley blocks. But what would happen if you were capsized? So imagine, here's Joe, he's in a lead, right?
I don't have.
And he has sprayed his entire boat
with
a dry lubricant.
And his dagger board.
And the dagger board. What's going to happen to Joe when he tries to get on the bottom of that boat and right the boat?
He's
going to slip off.
I've probably done everything but capsize,
so.
Just remember, that's what happened to me the day me and Chris went out, the V15.
you and Maddie tailed us, and we couldn't get the boat back up. So my crew, because the V-15 is a bigger boat with the same dagger board, and he decided that the dagger board in that boat always got stuck. We knew it was going into it. So he decided he was going to fix it, so he coated the whole dagger board in as much glue as he could possibly find. Now, when it was blowing 30 knots and the Vanguard 15 eventually flipped, what happened?
He was like that.
The real problem was, I can't swim that well. So I was trying to grab the board. But imagine this, guys. You know, they say butterfingers when you drop stuff a lot? All right, so try and grab this in moving water with your crew holding on to your foot because you couldn't keep up to the boat.
And also, if the boat goes all the way over, it's hard enough to reach the center board anyway.
If it turtles, it's a very big problem. Because now you're in the water, and realize, guys, when you're in the water next to an Opti that's turtled, you're about here. This is not easy for, I mean, even for me, I'm bigger than you guys, even for me to try and grab this, all right? Now everything's moving, so we're in waves, and this is covered in McGlue. It's tough. It's a losing battle.
So what Michael's saying is you have to plan for the unplanned.
Yeah.
You have to plan for things to go wrong, okay? And when you're sailing a dinghy,
they're going to have a dagger board or a center board.
But what's a dinghy?
Well, any little boat like this, a small boat. So when you're sailing, you're optimist. Any boat that's not a keel boat. So if you flip over, you got to plan on righting the boat. And so to right the boat, you need to rely on this and be able to grab it.
Have you ever heard a lot of people say, yeah, I've never capsized? Has anyone ever said that to you, I don't capsize?
I don't.
You will.
See? So the best line I've heard this whole year was, every single one of us is in between capsizes right now. So we may not have capsized today, we're going to have capsized yesterday, but guess what? It's coming again.
It's easy to flip a small boat.
But remember what we always say too, though, is if you capsize during a race, what happens? Is that the end of the race? Can you get the boat back up and still race?
Yeah.
So is getting the boat back up, should we take our time doing that, or maybe we should try and go quick? Quick, right?
Another thing I'm going to talk about here, and since you guys are all in school, you guys are studying math? Ooh, math. And has anybody discussed angles?
Yep.
Angles, right. So.
Yeah.
So angles. So now here's your boat in the water, right?
The square box.
The square box. Yes. This is it. You're sailing along. And underneath it is a dagger board, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now look at this. It all looks pretty straight, right?
Yeah.
This is going up 90 degrees. 90 degrees is when it's equal on both sides, right?
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So you've talked about, you know, a half a circle is 180 degrees.
Mm-hmm.
So 90 and 90, that's beautiful. But what happens if, when sailing a boat, it's like that?
That's not good.
It's not good. Now, do you think it might help you in some way?
I mean,
the Big America's Cup, they have canting dagger boards.
Yeah, because
yeah, yeah.
And on the rest of the boats.
Yep.
They have them
around
and on the Hugo Boss boat.
So if you can adjust this, well, that's huge. But on the Opti, you can't adjust it, right?
Well,
that's just a height. I'm talking about the angle now, Chris, right? So the angle, so we've talked about it being good to be square on either side, right? Now what would happen if it was down here wiggling back and forth?
That's just plain bad, yeah.
That's just plain bad. Joe says it's just plain bad.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well.
If you had a little curve at the end.
So let's look at this boat here. So those are angles, and you're gonna learn that and see. That in school. Maybe you guys can do a project on that in school. You can use your boat. How cool is that? You'll be the coolest guy in class.
School?
Look at this now.
My school's too small to fit my boat in the door.
You guys would like to have this solid, right? Look at this.
send it one down.
There has to be some room to get it up and down. Right. Any other comments, Joe?
There has to be a little room to get the centerboard up and down.
Room, yeah.
Yeah.
What about like during the winter time? There's a little room in your doorway too, right?
And things expand and contract with heat and cold.
And so, is it good to have gaps in your doorway in the winter time?
Yeah.
So what do you do? You block them up, you fill them up with something, right?
Oh, I know what I was going to do. Where to put it up?
And so on your centerboard, you can do the same thing. Here, feel it.
Okay, you're allowed to do that.
Most boats have it in there already.
So it's on the board, but it's in the trunk already.
Oh, I think I know what you're talking about.
In the trunk.
So wait, you can put like that little like thing around like the centerboard. It's hard to get my centerboard up.
You guys look in your boat.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
All right. Yeah, so actually, throughout we're saying this is Teflon spray, right? That helps the board go up and down. That tape is Teflon.
Oh.
That's a solid piece of it. So can this wear away over time?
Yeah.
Right? Use the boat 2 or 3 races, this may wear off. Exactly. So this boat, actually, if you guys look right here, feel right there. There is some Teflon tape in there.
How did it get down there anyway?
Just when the board's out, you just sneak it in. But is that enough tape to really keep that wobble out?
No.
So you can double it up if you need to.
So you guys can use this tape. See how it's thicker than what's in the boat right now?
That's really thick.
Exactly. So you'd use that instead. You put this right over what's in there now. And if you put a piece on each side, it'll take some of that play out. But what is it still? Teflon, so it's slippery step. Right? So if you just put like
you just like take the board in and out.
It'll move just the same, but our advantage now is that you're gonna take the side-to-side play out of it. So now the only play we have is up and down, which is the only thing we want to do. We don't want to go side to side.
So
yeah.
I do not know if my boat has it, but it's hard to get my board up and down. Yeah, mine is a little too, but can you explain us sandpaper.
You can wet sand your board. But here guys, stand back here at the transom and look at the angle right now. So 90 degrees is what we want.
Right, perfect. Perfect.
No, no. Well, yeah, no. Pretty much.
Yeah, but look at this.
See how much play the board has?
So every time you make a tack, what is your centerboard doing? It's wobbling.
Yeah, my centerboard never does.
So, the water's heavy. Is water pushing on this?
Yeah.
Okay, when you go through a tack, do you want it to immediately push you?
No.
Well, no. You want the board to get pressure on it right away. So you can squirt forward. So if you shim your board, your trunk rather, so if you shim it so there's less wobble, when you go from tack to tack, the boat goes push, 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 and it goes, and it's helping you advance forward.
I have a question. Do you have those for sunfish?
Yes, use the same thing in the sunfish. And another thing.
My board on my
shoulder. Plunk, plunk, plunk. Yep, you can. So any dinghy, this applies to any dinghy. You could be racing a sunfish, a laser, any dinghy that has a board in it, you can do the same thing with it.
So now like a hunter, you can't do it?
You could do that with your hunter. I see Chris and his dad, they go out sailing, and he has a...
I have bungee on the whole bottom.
Well, so we're not talking about a performance-oriented boat then. But if you want your boat to perform, like the nice thing about yacht racing, like, it's not about winning the race. It's gratifying. It's having fun, and it's gratifying to know that you got this boat, which is pretty simple. We're talking about having wind push you.
And now we're going to combine it with gas.
You don't need gas or smoke. Yeah, it's nice. But there's something gratifying about having the boat that you sailing it, you're the skipper, that you sailing it were able to advance it further ahead and faster than anybody else. And that's nice, you know, like I did good, you know, wow, that's nice. Okay, so little things like shimming the trunk, you guys can do that. That's a nice project that you can do with mom and dad at home. If you don't have this kind of stuff, which you don't have to have, does anybody have a shirt or a sweater that closes and it goes like, has Velcro? It's called hook and loop Velcro. You close this with it.
Right here.
Feel.
You see how it's thick but it's soft?
When you get Velcro, it has two pieces.
See,
it's
this
got
side.
A hooky side and a grabby side.
So this stuff, right. You guys can take this and use that in the trunk instead. You go either way.
So you either want to do it.
No, no, you wouldn't do this side. So what's this going to do to the board?
Scratch it up.
It's going to scratch it up. But the other thing too is, all right, feel this. I want you to push on it. You can push through it flat pretty quick, right? Not much to it. Push on this though. So it's thicker. The reason that happens, this is denser. So because it's denser, it's more of a cushion. Think of it like a pillow. Would you guys rather sleep with your head on this or on this?
Yeah.
Exactly. So we want to pillow that board in place.
That center board's going to be so happy. And you will too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this stuff here, when you get this in the store, it actually already comes with sticky on. So all you have to do is cut it, pull the sticky off, put it in the trunk. And then you could see, you could do this with it. If mommy and daddy have like tools at home, they can use that square and they can get it so it's like just perfect. Now, if you're out there, if you're out, let's say we're doing some horse racing, and you're out there with a horse that had like a bad leg, it limped.
That's pretty much the leg of the horse, who missed the other leg, and then, no, this is pretty much the reins.
You got it, Chris.
It's limping
because it's going back and forth. So this way, your boat, and will you feel good about having a horse that has got good strong legs and it's prancing along? Yeah, you're going to feel good about that. And that's something that any sailor can do. Okay? Beautiful. So that's a little thing about that. Michael was also going to talk about the little lines on here. You want to turn it upside down now?
You just put it right on the edge.
Yeah, okay.
Since it's on the edge, it's fine.
Alright, so
anyways, we're going to take your blade set. We're going to draw the lines on for you. Because can you see this? It's easy to see right now because we're all standing here, right? But if you're in the middle of a race, will you be able to see that line?
No.
No, right? So, we're going to get this guy up on edge. What we're going to do is we're going to mark. So, when you're going downwind, where should your board be? Maybe. We don't know. Two, is that dagger board big or small for him?
Big. Huge.
Really big,
yeah.
The board's big, I think that's bigger than the rotor.
I mean, it's bigger than the sunfish dagger board. It's bigger than the laser dagger board, pretty much.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm going to be sailing a Mercury, and I'm like, I'm not used to sailing a normal boat, so.
Opti's kind of. But so what we're going to do, guys, we're going to put the boat on edge, and then we're going to show you. Because the other thing, too, is when we're racing down here, what's really important to do between races? What do we always say?
Seaweed,
right?
Yeah.
How far do you pull up the board for seaweed?
All the way.
How do you know?
Hey, get it off, yeah.
Do we want to do that quick?
No, for a little, like, you get out 2 or 3 seconds.
Two or 3 seconds. Let's say you're in the middle of a race, you're in the middle of a pack of boats, and you have nowhere to go but directly through the island of seaweed. Right,
so
you're going to pull it up all the way. What we're going to do is we're going to mark for you guys on your boards where is full up. That way you're going to pull up until you see that line drop back down. Right away. That way it's a quick change, just up, see the line, back down. So here, we're going to put this
I actually call that cleansing the center board. Cleansing the dagger board. You want to clean it off.
I'm going to sneak around this way.
Okay.
This poke.
Okay, so I'll be the support.
Alright, guys, so come around to this side.
Back side.
pulley looks like
a problem. Looks like effort.
Okay. So what's the dagger doing right now? Is that all the way down or all the way up? Right? When are we going to use it all the way down?
Upwards, unless it's really windy.
Well, actually, so, why did you say bring it up or a little bit when it's windy?
Because if it's really windy and you're healing a little bit, if you bring it up just a little bit, it helps you kind of heal less if you don't weigh much.
Because what's it doing? Joe, you said it before. What does it do?
It converts sideways energy to forward energy and you bleed.
So if we bring that board up a little bit, what are we going to do to that energy? Are you going to spill a little bit of it?
You're going to spill a little bit of it, and you're going to drift a little
more. You're going to drift a little more, but what's our trade-off? So that we can sail flatter. What's faster? Flat or all the way up like this? Is this fast right here?
No.
Well, you guys win the race, sail like this.
And the one thing about these, they have a square bow, and it's not overboard so much, so it's always on the...
Yes. It's always hitting the
wind. So it's always
going down.
Unless you can back
out
and get a hood
in the
legs.
Yeah. See, now how, so normally where are we sitting on the ramp? While we're up on the ramp. Normally.
Up there.
He's sitting up here.
I would normally sit up there in that situation.
We should have a little doll.
Where do we sit? So where do you want our forward leg to be? If we're hiking. So you want the side of your leg touching right here, right? And where are our feet? Under the straps, right? So where are your feet when you're in the aisle? Are they just wherever you want to be, are they over here? You always want under the strap, right?
Okay.
That's the next part. So in those big waves, Chris, where should you be? Normally, if we're going to be sitting right here, where do we want to go to in the big waves?
Here?
Back, right?
On the back of the bus!
Sort of like you said, is the Opti weight sensitive?
Yes. Very. If you're too heavy in light wind, the whole boat will probably tip.
That's what happens to me, except I barely weigh anything, so.
Well, but remember though, what did we say? The lighter wind, so in heavier winds, right, with big waves, what do we want to do? First thing we're going to do is we're going to move back in the boat.
Yeah.
Right? What's that going to do?
Just like plane the boat.
Plane it? Or what's it going to do to the front of the boat?
Lift it up.
Lift it up.
Lift it up.
I guess it's
loud.
If you see a big some chop coming, you really just jerk at that and lift the bar up like that.
Uh-huh. Because think about it this way. What's the front of an Opti shape like?
Square.
It's square.
So when a wave hits a square, what happens?
It slows down.
Slows down a lot.
The wave wins.
Yeah, the wave will win. The wave will take all of your speed and say, nope. It's like getting
break. Especially when it's a southwestern wind at my yacht club.
Yeah.
Well, I sail out with Vince, one of the windiest spots on the bay. Mm-hmm. They say if you can sail there, you can sail anywhere.
But, so what happens there? That but you have that short, chop, steep chop,
I've
right?
Had, I've had chop to here before, maybe a bit higher, and I've launched over it, lose all my speed, drop, and have a weight break over the front of my boat.
Right? Because on the south shore, what do we have? Do we have these big swells that are just nice and little ramps? Or do we have that short, steep chop that looks like these sores is coming at you?
Yeah, right? It's like that.
So what we want to do is ideally is if we're burying the bow into each wave right here like this, we're going to slow it down, right?
And also and before it over your boat.
Exactly. But now when that's a short, steep chop, and let's say the waves are only a foot apart like they are on the bay, what's that going to do?
Glide over the waves.
Yeah, well, it's probably nose dive.
Exactly. So if you get that nose up, though, you can sail right across the tops of them instead of hitting the brakes on every single one. Do you want to hit the brakes every 5 feet in Opti?
No.
No, you want to go as fast as you can.
Yeah, and one time I nose dived on one of the waves.
At my yacht club, it's a constant 10 to 12 knots. So
you can drive it.
Chris, why don't you see if you can pull the centerboard up? What do you have to do to pull the centerboard up? See, remember you talked about when your boat turned upside down, the centerboard fell out?
Because I was down
landing. Wouldn't that be a nice little trick to do, that little loop?
Mine looks like that.
Yeah, so if you put a loophole in that, and we can help you with that. You put a loophole in that, when you do go upside down, You don't have to worry about the board falling down.
Now that's when the board's all the way down. If the board's up halfway, what does that loop do?
It goes like there.
Here, pull it halfway up.
Like this.
Then you're in the boat.
And then it goes like that, and then you go like that. Mm-hmm.
How far up do you think we are now?
Not half, but
nearly half.
All right, ready? Walk around the other side.
One half might be up here.
No,
that's more than half.
See?
That's half.
Alright, ready? So push that board all the way down. Oop. Alright, now run back to the side. Board over. Okay, ready? So this is our fold down line.
Yeah, it's fine.
Oops. Okay. Fold down,
right?
Okay. Now we're back to the other side, guys. I want you to pull that board up until you read the word fold. So see how big the trunk is in this boat? It takes up a lot of that blade surface. It's just going to sit the trunk.
And you can't have just the center board halfway up. Mm-hmm. Like that.
Now here's what we're going to do. Without looking on Jim's side, I want you to pull the board up to exactly where it's at, flush with the bottom of the boat. So we're going to do a seaweed clear. Where do you think it is? We're not going to tell you any hints or anything. I think that's all the way up. Joe, what do you think?
I think.
So here's what we're going to do. Ready? Put your mark.
No, that's a bit.
Okay, watch out. So here's our mark. This is right there. Joe, go.
It's like there.
Right there?
Yeah.
Okay. Joe, there. Full up. You can go any way you want.
Like there.
Think?
I think that's actually more
than. So we're shooting for flush with the bottom of the boat. Chris, ready? Pull that tag board out all the way. So,
that's a bit
more. So here's our guesses. So go to the other side of the boat. I'm gonna put it down to right where you guys guessed. Alright, so right now we're at Chris's mark. Let's pull up for Chris. Ready? So now we're gonna go to Joe.
Oh.
That's it.
That was just like that's close.
What is that? That's it.
Nope, that's still you're almost there, though. That's maybe an inch and a half or so. Well, what happens is, when sailing in seaweed, if you go through the energy of pulling up the board so the weed falls off, if you just go this far, you went through all that effort of pulling the board up, you slipped sideways, so you lost some as far as your
board,
and you still have seaweed on it.
So you've done nothing. You may think you just did everything. All right, that's it. I've got fresh clean board. I'm going to keep going. But all you just did was move the seaweed up the board a little bit, and that's it.
Sunlight, come on.
So here's what we're going to do. Now we're going to push it all the way up to perfectly flush.
Okay, guys, you do push it so where it's right flush with the bottom.
Oh, wow, hell, you're pretty close, Jeff.
That's it.
This is Joe's mark. Come back to this side, guys. So this is Joe's mark right there. So what we like to do is, you guys can take a Sharpie. Remember we were saying these lines? Do these lines actually line up to anything? No, right? So what you can do is...
Can I hold me into this?
Huh? Mark right there. So now we know, as you guys are sailing, what does that help us do?
Clear the seaweed.
So if you want to clear the seaweed, what are we going to do?
Go to that line.
You're going to pull it up until you see the line. Once you see the line, you know the seaweed's off, push it right back down. So we take all the guesswork out of it.
So I can do this at home?
Absolutely, yeah. Easiest way to do it is with the Sharpie. Yeah, it stays
with you. Mine was so close, though.
You were very... Now, so is that good or bad that you were just a little high?
That's actually good.
Yeah. It's good. It's not bad.
At least it works.
Exactly. It works. Gets the job done.
Mine worked a little bit.
Oh, kind of.
Yeah, I drift a lot.
You drift too much.
Remember, so it's all speeds. We want to get that up down as quick as possible. So if we pull too far, now we're just kind of wasting. Granted, it's only like a millisecond, but when you're in one design, you have a millisecond count. So up down as quick as you can, done. Now let's mark out halfway. So we're going downwind, right?
Okay.
So if that's full.
Can I try half?
They say just below the boom is halfway.
Round two guesses. So.
Like just stand.
Here. Go all the way back down.
Can I try first?
You're all going to do it again. So, go for it. Going downwind. Where are we going with it? Final answer.
It's like Jeopardy.
Jeopardy.
Joe, where would you go?
Let's say.
No, you can't look down.
That's what I did for the last
one. No.
Maybe like.
This is blocked.
Okay.
Halfway up. This is where we stop it.
If I was actually going down, then I'd have it up higher. But this is about halfway.
Where would you normally go? Let's see.
When going down, downwind?
Yep.
Look at our line. So you just took all the board out of the water entirely.
Most of the way out.
Most of the way.
I do
want
to. That's not until it's like just below the boom.
Yeah, good. Okay, let's see. Go for the middle. Where do you think it is? Is your bat where Joe is?
What?
Say here.
Normally, I would pick it up.
All right, ready? Pretty much got it. Guys, we're all in the same spot. Go to the other side. Let's just show you the quick variations of what you came up with. All right. So, Chris.
Mm-hmm.
This is you.
That's like.
All right. So, how are you looking? Good.
That's pretty good.
Pretty good? Mm-hmm. Tana, that's you. So, pretty good. And we move back to Joe, and that's Joe.
That's like, well,
that's awful.
That's Joe's.
That's not how I would lift it up, though. I would lift it up so it's just below the boom.
Just below the boom. Yeah.
And that's a smart thing, because if you get in a jam and your boom's going back and forth, if your boom... You could crash, yeah.
Tana's middle tie for the bridle, if this is really tight, where's the boom gonna bend?
Right there.
It's gonna bend there, which if you want power, okay, you want to be able to use all the power and then decide what you want to do with it. So if this is super tight, what's the leech and the sail gonna do? If this is gonna bend up, this is gonna open up, right? So you're gonna lose power. So by having the bridle tied properly, where it's anchored at the two anchor points, they take up most of the energy. This is just a preventer to keep your sail ring where you attach your main sheet in the spot that you want it. Go ahead, Chris.
What's the difference of a sail that is just like, so this and that, and a sail like that? And what's the difference of a sail like this?
Well, with this sail, all the sails are going to have a back, and a front, and a bottom.
Yeah, but I'm talking about, like, I'm the sail, and that's the back of the boat.
Yeah, okay, so what we're going to do is everything we talk about is going to apply to every sail. Sail makers work really hard to get the shape of the sail right. You see, like these triangular panels here, they're all different.
Yeah, I've also got another sail that's that radio sail. Should I take that out as an example?
Oh, we can take the radial sail out later, yeah. Cool. And so there's different shapes. This is a cross-cut sail. Okay. With this sail, what we're talking about, Chris, is being able to open up the leech and lose energy. You can open up the leech by having the by using a bendy boom that we talked about, or by having the like easing the sail out, or you can ease the sprit. Remember we talked about easing the sprit?
Is this a small or big boom?
This is the normal size boom.
Yep.
Like big fat boys who are out sailing optimist, like much bigger than you guys.
Like you?
Yeah, like me when I was out sailing with you the other day, you know?
About 14, 15
years. Yeah, so those 14 and 15 year olds, they weigh like 130 pounds. In order for them to keep the energy in their sail, sometimes they even get a fatter boom, a bigger boom. And so it's not going to bend. And this is something that will apply all through your sailing. The shape of the sail is affected by your mast and your boom. And then the rigging. Most boats, after you go off from the Opti, you're going to have stays to hold the sail up, and you'll be able to adjust those to control the shape of the mast.
Like a mast rig.
The mast rig. We can do that, and we can talk about mast rig. I've seen Tana using a tape measure. Why would you use a tape measure on an optimist?
I did that last.
We can measure how far forward or back the mast is bent.
Right, so you can measure it this way or this way.
But depending on your wetness and wind conditions, you want it bent.
I see an ooh question there.
What's the mast, right here where the mast slides into the little thing? And it slides forward and backwards?
Yes.
Does that adjust a big thing?
That's adjustable.
Yeah.
Exactly, that's what we're talking about. So now you can adjust it. If you bring it further forwards, right, you tighten up your leech more, and you bring more of your energy up front in the sail, which brings you through flatter water and lighter water faster. Okay, you want to power up. On days when it's super windy, super windy.
Yay!
We love super windy days.
I pull my sail all the way in.
Windy for me is or fine.
I just pull it all the way in and just go for it.
Now remember, talking about trying to get the boat across the finish line first, that gratification that we get from winning a race, what would you want to do with the rake of the sail,
anyway,
of the mast?
Why is healing not... And why is healing?
Because less of your board is in the water.
So healing is this way.
Yeah, I know, but why?
Rake is this way.
I know.
Two different things. Oh, my!
But why does healing slow you down?
Why does healing slow you down?
Yeah.
There's a lot of reasons why healing slows you down.
Because most of the board is out of the boat.
Most of the boat's out of the water. This boat is really flat.
Yeah, I'm talking about both of you.
Well, when you heel the boat over, okay, as you heel the boat over, that edge of the boat is going to develop a lot of resistance. So it's almost like the bows hitting against the waves, and now you have the side of the boat, that chine hitting the waves. That's bad karma. That's like bad energy. We want good energy. Okay, so if there's less of this, the boat's gonna, and someone used the word glide before. You want the boat to glide over the sea. Yeah, so Joe gets a star because he used the word glide. You've all gotten a lot of stars. I'm really impressed. You guys are putting this all together. And that's the nice thing about this, is that we're sitting down on a cold, rainy day when the breeze is way up and it's...
Yeah.
Not a day for us to go sail, but we're learning about sailing.
Also, guys, another thing about when your boat is heeled, when the boat is flat, where is the mast? Straight up and down, right? When it's heeled, where is the mast compared to the boat?
It's like getting...
Is the top of the mast inside the boat, or is the top of the mast outside your rail?
Outside the rails.
And what is that going to do when it pushes? Is that going to steer your boat on you? It's going to give you something called weather helm. The mast is going to push the boat around and want to turn it into the wind. Now, what do? You crank over with the rudder,
yep.
and the rudder's a big break.
And remember on the Opti, how
so
big is that
flat
rudder? So Bob's usually doing this on lasers. Now let's say double the rudder size, what's it going to do? Double the effect, right?
Yeah.
And with less sail.
A laser rudder's too small for the boat.
But remember, guys, when you're sailing upwind, I've seen a lot of you doing it where you're hiking and the boat's totally out of control and you've got that rudder pulled all the way to the side and you're just holding on. Is that fast? It feels fast because you're like, wow, there's spray and I feel the breeze on my face. You're like, man, I'm going so fast. You're actually slowing down. Yeah, the boat next to you that's flat is going to go right past you.
So what I got out of this was that I talked about the hull. And then Mr. Terry talked about the mast, and then there's also the blades in the water. We talked about that, where the rudder, if you have to steer to keep the boat on its course, again, it's sideways to the flow of the water, so it's going to act as a brake. So they all factor in. It's really easy to think about one element of the boat, but they all fit together. It's like a piece of a puzzle.
So, this is just on the top of my mind. If you had a trailer like this and put a wheel on the front, and then
they make those.
I mean, like both the boats. Back to
there is one. Here.
So maybe someday, someday in November on a Sunday.
Definitely not today.
You guys can come out and we'll ride the Dinghy Shop's blow cart in the parking lot down here.
Oh, that is so cool.
Okay. And everything applies. Everything applies. All the things you've learned. Now, how do you stop the boat?
This is a big thing, guys. So in the blow cart, there are no brakes. So how do you stop an Opti? What's that called?
Backwinding.
You can stop out that way. Right?
Or if you've got current that's hitting you back, you can lift the center board off.
Okay, well, with the blow cart where you have no current,
you
have to rely on the wind. And you know what's really amazing? I thought that with the blow cart, since you're going so fast, you're going 25, 30 miles an hour, you're moving
it's fast.
I thought that you would backwind and you'd keep going for a long time. You know,
and then
stop
you have to
like
do
that.
Like you jumble around.
It's amazing.
You just, like,
that energy, that reverse energy, stops you. In your sailboat race, Joe, as you're getting ready to get up on the line, if you're too soon, too early, you push the boom out, boop, you stop. And then you're ready to go. If you're over the line early, push the boom back. So you want to stay on the free course side of the line.
Or you keep an iron and then you just turn, and then on the starboard. And you're an iron, and it's 3, 2, 1, and then go.
Yeah.
And then you just turn your boat, and then you go.
So
right?
What you're talking about is not in irons, because in irons you're in peril. You can have no control. You're talking about luffing the boat, like letting the sail out and letting it go like this, so you don't power up the sail yet.
Yeah.
And then, when you're ready to go, you're looking around, and all of a sudden you go, and whoosh, you scoot out. And you have to do that. So, Tana's looking at Chris, who's looking at Joe, who's looking at Tana, who's looking at Chris, who's looking at, you guys all looking at each other and thinking, who's going to be the first one to pull the trigger? Right? And someone's trying to get the other guy to pull the trigger too fast, and he goes over the line, and so he has to go back to start promptly.
I have a question. Would you ever be able to make the centerboard wire and then put one of those pedal things in? And if there's no wind, you just pedal around?
Well, I like that, yeah. On light air days, wouldn't that be great? Just have a pedal.
Yeah, in the middle of the boat, like right there, and then...
You may notice you tap dancing in the bottom of the boat. But guys, remember how Jim was just talking about cheating?
Yeah.
Alright, when is it really important to sheet fast?
Well, if you cross the line and
then connecting a pair of weights.
Well, hang on, when is it, Joe?
At the beginning of the race and at the leeward mark.
At all your mark rapids? Is it always, should you take your time letting the sail in now?
No.
So when you're at the leeward mark, how do you want to pull in that main sheet?
Yeah.
But you see the mark coming, right? So can you get ready for that rounding before you get to mark?
Yep.
Alright, ready? So if you guys are pulling from here.
And there's also wind power going against the sail.
Now look at Michael's fingers. You see, he's not using his whole hand. He's just using his fingers. Watch.
Think of yourselves like a crab, guys. Think of it like this. Ready? But here you go. If you really want to pull that sail in quick, don't pull from here. Pull from here, right? So what you want to do is we're going to be here, like being an Opti all over again. You don't want to pull from here, because how much are we getting every time we pull?
Absolutely nothing.
You see how there's a delay, too, every time I pull? Yep. You see every time I have to reset, I'm making a delay. So it's pull, delay. Pull, delay. Pull, delay.
And
push me back out. Right? And so I'm only getting about, let's say, 4 to 8 inches of line every time I pull. What you want to do is you want to pull from the block. So as we're getting close to the mark, you can reach down to the block. See, there's only 3 delays instead of 10 delays. And the whole time, though, you see what I'm doing with these fingers? This is my second hand. So how many hands, well, do you need your whole hand to hold that tiller in place? No, right?